thank the organizer to have accepted our presentation. And what we will present today is less theoretical than the previous presentation, as we will present a work in progress to develop an ABM. This is a work in progress with a computer scientist at University of Nice in France. And this ABM aims to explore the respective role of social and environmental factors in the evolution of the settlement system during the Roman period. And as the development of the model is still ongoing, we will only present the conceptual model and the first implementation on the NetLogo platform. And but we won't discuss the result because they are too preliminary. So this project is part of a wider research agenda devoted to the analysis of long-term dynamics of the settlement system. Since the beginning of the 90s, a group of French archaeologists collaborating with geographers elaborated a series of indicators to describe and compare settlements' intensity, hierarchical structure, and spatial distribution in various areas of southern and central France between the Iron Age and the early Middle Age. Based on more than 2,000 settlements identified in field surveys, these indicators were developed on the same methodological basis in order to make the result comparable between different regions. And the main interest of such a goal of such a diachronic and comparative approach is to investigate the processes, both social and environmental, that underlie this transformation of the settlement system. The result allowed to identify regularities in the settlement dynamics observed both in southern and central Gaul, as well as local specificities. For the beginning of the Roman period, two main patterns are identified. First, a strong increase in the number of rural settlements from the 2nd century BC to the 1st century AD, which causes a more concentrated spatial distribution of the settlements. And from the 1st century AD, the development of a new type of rural settlements, the Roman villa, also leads to a more hierarchized settlement structure. Secondly, in most areas, a steep reduction of the number of settlements starts at the end of the 1st century and continues during the 2nd century AD, resulting in a more dispersed spatial distribution, while the hierarchical diversity of the settlements decrease. In order to go beyond this observation of the state of the settlement system at different periods, it is necessary to investigate the processes responsible for its transformation through time. And this interest for dynamics motivated the use of dynamic modeling to simulate the processes of creation, abandonment, or maintenance of the rural settlements, which underlies the quantitative, qualitative, and spatial evolution of the settlement system. Agent-based modeling is particularly well-suited to this goal, as it allows to explore how the interactions between the system components at the micro level generate new properties and structure of the system at the macro level. As the decision to create, abandon, or maintain an exploitation mainly depends on its owner, we chose to simulate the behavior of Gallo-Roman landowners regarding their rural properties. As modeling necessarily imposes to simplify reality, we only consider three types of landowners with different socio-economical status: farmers, big landowners, and aristocrats, meaning magistrates who play a political role in the city. The farmers can only own farms, whereas the big landowners and aristocrats can own farms and villas. The size intervals allowed for each type of exploitation were chosen according to historical and archaeological data. The landowners can choose between five actions regarding each of their exploitations. They can maintain it without change, enlarge or improve it, abandon it or create a new one. And their decision depends first on their socio-economical status and secondly on the profit they derive from each exploitation or expect to derive if they create a new one. The socio-economical status of the landowner defines his initial economical power, the number and type of rural exploitation he can own, and his behavior and perception. And in order to include some fuzziness and nuance in the agent's behavior, we integrated cognitive agents in the ABM using the belief, desire, intention model, which allows to implement agents able to behave according to their knowledge, beliefs, and desire. Also, these parameters are based on archaeological and historical knowledge. They include a large part of hypotheses, especially regarding this perception and behavior of the agents. But this is indeed one of the interests of modeling to to be able to change and play these parameters in order to refine and test our hypothesis. The other element taken into account by the landowner to decide what to do with each of his exploitation is the profit he derives from it or expects to derive if he creates a new exploitation. These profits depend first on the production capacity of the exploitation according to its environmental context. And at this first stage, we choose five very stylized types of environmental units: alluvial plain, foothills, plateau, sedimentary basin, and hill slopes. And the profit also takes into account the cost of transporting the production to the nearest marketplace. We selected two types of town, one city capital and three other towns. And we credited the city capital with a specific attractivity for the Gallo-Roman aristocrats, as this is the place where they exercise their political functions. Therefore, in the model, the aristocrats must have at least one exploitation in a radius of 10 kilometers from the capital. In order to define and calibrate these parameters, we instantiated the model in a specific spatio-chronological context, which is the territory of the Roman colony of Forum Iulii, present Fréjus, in southeast of France, where we collected and studied archaeological and paleo-environmental data for more than 20 years. This instantiation will also allow to place the simulation in a realistic environment based on the present landscape of this area. Also, this is not fully implemented yet in the ABM. The model also aims to integrate the impact of two external factors on the production capacity of the rural exploitations. The first one is the climate, whose evolutions have an impact on land fertility. And for the moment, this impact is simulated in a very rough manner by randomly increasing or decreasing the landscape unit's fertility. But for the future, we plan to combine the ABM with a paleoclimatic model. And the second factor is the macroeconomical context within the Roman Empire, which might have an impact on the economical power of the landowners. For example, according to the fluctuation of fiscality and of the state of the market. But this economical factor has not been implemented yet.
At each iteration, the landowner's decision-making regarding each of his exploitation depends on the combination of the evolution of his economical power, which can be equivalent, higher or lower than his revenue at the previous iteration, and the profit derived from his exploitation. In the simplest case, when the landowner's revenue is lower than his previous one and the profit from his exploitation is high, he will maintain it without change. Whereas, if the profit from the exploitation is low, we will abandon it, but only after five consecutive years of low profit. As a farmer can only own one farm, new exploitation can only be created by big landowners and aristocrats when their revenue is superior or equivalent, but it is in this last case, the landowner can only create new exploitations if he abandons the same number of exploitations. When the landowner revenue is superior, he can choose to maintain his exploitation without change, enlarge it or improve it. By improvements, we mean various agricultural and hydro-agricultural structures such as irrigation or drainage ditches, land terraces, stone clearance, which can be laid out to improve the production of a piece of land. This creates feedbacks between agents' behavior and the properties of their environment, as they can improve land productivity. Another feedback loop is introduced in the model by degrading land productivity after 5 years of consecutive exploitation. Besides the economical value of the exploitation, its symbolic value is also taken into account. This refers to the attachment evidenced by ancient texts and epigraphical documents of some landowners to one specific exploitation, for example, if it's the original domain of the family, or if it's located close to the city capital. In the model, this symbolic value will push the landowner to keep his exploitation even when its profits is low. Following this scheme, repeated landowners' decision-making produces a change in macro-level settlement pattern in terms of number, type, and location of the settlements. Although we built these parameters using textual and archaeological data, we are aware that they are highly hypothetical. But at this stage of the modeling process, our aim was to produce an implemented version of the model, even with rough parameters, in order to be able to test and refine them later on. So to ease the collaboration with the computer scientists in charge of implementing the EVM, we used two widespread formalisms to describe the conceptual model. The EODD protocol for overview, design concept details, developed by Grimm et al. In 2006, which is standard protocol to describe agent-based models, and the UML formalism to draw diagrams describing the classes or component of the model as shown here. And here to describe the relationship between these entities as in the activity diagram. Beyond the utility to communicate with the computer scientists, these describing tools happen to be very useful for us for the conception of the model itself, as they oblige to deepen our hypothesis on the simulated systems. The first version of the ABM was released only a month ago, so we won't discuss its results as the model still needs to be tested and improved, especially concerning the environmental, economical, and demographic dynamics. But to conclude, we would like to point out some more general considerations about the complex relations between models and reality. A model, as stated earlier by Isa, a model is a simplified representation of a reality which gives sense to this reality and hence allows to understand it. Thus, archaeological models are not designed to reproduce past reality, which is out of reach, but they are useful to select within our hypothesis which ones are the most likely to have produced the archaeological remains we observe. In this way, models are tools to think, not only to test theories, but also to elaborate them. But even in that sense, the question of the realism of the model always arises, especially during two phases of the modeling process. During the modeling building, we often face the insufficiency of archaeological and historical data, which are usually heterogeneous, fuzzy, and ambiguous. But when it comes to define the model parameters, it is necessary to specify values and thresholds, which implies to reduce drastically the complexity and richness of the data at the risk of oversimplification. At the other end of the modeling process, the validation of the simulated hypothesis implies to compare the model outputs with archaeological records. But a rather good match between the simulation and reality is not enough for this validation, as different processes can create similar patterns. This is particularly crucial when the model adopts a realistic design, like our model, where the use of a real geographical space for the simulated world increases the risk to focus on the simulated spatial pattern. Instead, we should privilege the analysis of the statistical outputs, which show the evolution of the settlement structure and can be compared to the quantitative, hierarchical, and spatial indicators of the observed Gallo-Roman settlement system we measured in various areas. Thank you for your attention.